My name is Luca Faccio. I'm a photographer and live in Vienna. I've been able to travel to North Korea 7 times since 2005, getting a picture of the country's people and their worldview. During these trips, I saw more than I was allowed to be shown. Any journalist visiting the country is accompanied by minders around the clock. I've known mine for a few years now. Here, I'm taking pictures with them. They check what you film, who you talk to, and what about. I see the familiar images, but time and again I see new ones. I notice that there are a few new ideas for many of the people caught in this collective mindset. A paranoid system, one that I too have to submit to. It is a requirement on every visit to start by going to the statues of the two great leaders. I'm familiar with this. They're part of the large Mansudae monument, which commemorates North Korea's fight against the Japanese occupation. The capital, Pyongyang, is home to more than 3 million people and to a middle class that's becoming, economically, increasingly independent of the state. A middle class that could, in the long term, become a problem for the regime. Around 2 million mobile phones have been approved since 2008. I'm currently being monitored with one. They're used for phone calls too, but only domestic ones and for selected citizens, such as my minder. It's the first time I've been allowed to travel by taxi, of course, only with my minder. We're going to a supermarket in which I even discover typically Western products. In my opinion, the people are strikingly well-dressed. There are casinos and I even spot some Viennese coffee culture here. Of course, I'm the only guest. Much to my surprise, the state television shows Western propaganda figures. During my visit, the controversial Slovenian rock group Laibach was the first Western band to be allowed to perform. The dreams of reunification between North and South still exist here, but they regularly melt away as a result of new provocations and everyday aggressive posturing at what's been called the world's most dangerous border. I've tried to find out what the North Koreans are really like, because for me, there are perfectly normal people behind the system. Appearances are deceptive. I'm not in a conventional souvenir shop. I'm in Panmunjom in the demilitarized zone. There's no shortage of coffee, smiles, and cartridges.
Coffee, please.
Coffee. This is the highway from Pyongyang to Seoul. This is the railway line that has been interrupted for more than 50 years now. Here we have manuscripts by Kim Il-sung. The great leader, Kim Jong-il, visited this place 4 times.
I drive through the demilitarized zone with my minders, 3 in total. The atmosphere's unpleasant, full of tension and surreal. On the day before my visit, shots were fired. Today, military exercises are taking place. It smells of gunpowder and war. My minder tells me his army will protect me. That's no comfort. The zone stretches across the entire peninsula along the 38th parallel. This is where the Allies arbitrarily divided the country after the Second World War. The border zone is 248 kilometers long and 4 kilometers wide. It's considered the most dangerous border in the world. I meet a colonel here. I've known him for 10 years. So well, in fact, that we often drink schnapps together after our meeting. It's clear to me that there's the person in the uniform and the person underneath it.
This is where the truce and the end of the war were negotiated. For you, taking pictures is the most important thing. You don't need an explanation.
The colonel takes me from one barracks to the next. It's always important to mention how often which leader has been to the site. He has to tell me that. but he's clearly also interested in other things.
How does Austria report on the current situation on the Korean Peninsula? This is the most significant August location with regard to the armistice. 2 days after this building was completed, on the 27th of July 1953, the armistice was agreed and signed here. On the day it was signed, the Americans wanted to move the building northwards. They didn't manage because journalists saw it and prevented it. On the 3rd of March 2012, the Supreme Leader, Kim Jong-un, said during a visit, "If there is another war with the Americans, we won't sign a truce. We'll destroy the Americans until they capitulate."
Evil Americans who move buildings. Sounds like a fairy tale to me. The casual way in which war gets discussed here sounds to me like Italians talking about football. My trip continues. We're on our way to the notorious Blue Buildings in which the meetings between the delegates from North and South Korea take place. It's the exact border between the two countries, drawn by the victorious allies of the Second World War.
I have to say, you made a real effort with the photographs.
Here they are, the Blue Huts, the start of the drama for the Korean people, in the middle of an impenetrable border. The Berlin Wall was a garden fence by comparison, it said. A few meters from here is South Korea. Anyone wanting to get across is shot.
I've heard there are some foreigners who are nice to us here, but who make money with us when they get home.
I later learned that the interpreter gave me a different translation, maybe to save face or maybe on purpose, I don't know. Critical questions are dangerous here. There are 13 newspapers in North Korea, but only one opinion. Back in Pyongyang, I want to find out what people think about the two Koreas reuniting. I'm allowed to talk about this with a young student.
I want to tell them about our reunification. So all the Korean people have to try for the reunification of our country.
The next obligatory item on the agenda is a visit to Kim Il-sung's birthplace. He's the founder of the state, and the house where he was born is a veritable site of pilgrimage that everyone has to visit.
His father, mother, whole family members were fighting against the Japanese. So in these surroundings, President Kim Il-sung was born. From early times, received patriotic and revolutionary education from his parents. So our great comrade Kim Jong-un, not only young woman, not only young people, it is all Korean people very loved him. So it's because he very like our President Kim Il-sung, he very like our General Kim Jong-un.
Everyone loves the great leader. But is that true? It becomes impossible to determine what's real and what's staged here. The same flowers here are sold several times a day. They're laid once and then they're collected again by an overseer standing at the back and then they're recycled. Eternal veneration for the eternal president. My next stop is the monument to the foundation of Korea's Workers' Party. 50 metres tall and built of granite, it depicts the communist symbols, the hammer and sickle, supplemented by a paintbrush that's meant to represent intellectuals. The reliefs, by the way, depict the battle of the workers against the imperialist threat. Here in the Church of the Life-Giving Trinity, I get a surprise. When the Russian punk band Pussy Riot were arrested, I documented an art event in a Russian Orthodox church in Vienna. I was even questioned by counterintelligence as a result. Here in this Russian Orthodox church in North Korea, I used the topic to talk indirectly about human rights. According to the Christian NGO Open Doors, North Korea takes last place in the global rankings for persecution of Christians.
Pussy Riot sang and danced in bikinis in Moscow's Christ the Savior Cathedral to demonstrate against the Putin regime during the Russian election campaign. I believe the musicians insulted the Holy Mother of God.
I wouldn't want to imagine what would happen here if the Holy Kim were insulted. For a North Korean priest, the man is quite well informed, in my opinion. The information from the outside world must come from somewhere. If I were to ask direct questions about human rights, it would immediately be seen as a provocation and could make my stay much harder. In any case, people deny what they don't want to talk about anyway. Concentration camps, purges, shootings, none of that exists here. Officially, it's a paradise on earth. North Koreans are taught from childhood to submit to the state ideology, to sacrifice their individual existence to the collective. Even the youngest children are called upon to denounce adults who express dissatisfaction with the leader and the party. I want to know how and where the brainwashing starts. I tried to find answers to that question in a school for more than 1,000 students. But during my visit, the corridors are deserted. The headmistress takes me through the rooms. Everything seems very new, very tidy. The schools I know look different.
This is our cloning lab. Here's a microscope. And on the screen you can see a cell magnified 1,500 times. Here are the technical processes to clone animals.
She tells me that Kim Jong-il had declared nano and biotechnology to be at the heart of North Korean science. It looks like it. And so that I don't just see empty classrooms, the headmistress takes me to a class that's just having a maths lesson. It all seems very staged to me. I don't know what the students here are really being taught. When I start filming, the students use their calculators like mad, but the calculations don't seem to make any sense. I believe the students are just pretending. The pictures of the great leaders are everywhere. They hang in every room. When I ask one of the students whether he knows the man who discovered America, Christopher Columbus, he's silent at first. Then the headmistress asks me to leave the room because I'm interfering with the lecture. But there's another surprise in store for me during this visit. I was invited to play football with 30 teenagers. I've never experienced anything like that in North Korea. It's a great moment for me in the Genoa jersey. For them, it wasn't about winning. I think the students played poorly on purpose to make me look better. At times, there were 200 to 300 students sitting around the pitch. It almost felt like a stadium.
Like when you said you felt so happy you could die. Told myself that you were right for me, but felt so lonely in your company. But that was love and it's an ache I still remember.
Because of the latest UN sanctions, North Korea has been forced to be self-sufficient. No raw materials or products may be exported. Given the current economic situation, it's hopefully only a matter of time before North Korea gives up its stubborn nuclear policy. I'm allowed to visit a textile factory. I've been here four times already, but the manager's new.
Come in and take a look.
I'm shown a showcase spinning mill. The workers, largely women in this case, are the pride of the nation. Officially, the people earn €5 a month. It's very probable that their actual wages are even lower. The people here can only survive with food stamps handed out by the government. Malnutrition is so common in North Korea that people have become demonstrably smaller. I have to say, the factory is strikingly clean. The workers are laughing and joking. It's obvious that the country needs economic reforms. Exports to China have dropped by half. In addition, the country is losing large parts of its agricultural land every year as a result of environmental disasters such as drought and flooding, making it powerless in the face of climate change, like so many poor countries. And because of the new sanctions, North Korea's even more isolated than before. I'm glad I was allowed to photograph some of the women. None of this can be taken for granted here. My minders are responsible for my proper behaviour. If I don't stick to certain rules, I could put them in a difficult situation too. For some years now, the increase in private vehicles has been shaping the face of the city. It demonstrates that there's something happening in the capital, and the private economy at least. New buildings are being constructed, and the city's silhouette increasingly reminds me of the financial districts of well-known Asian cities. But in reality, these buildings are home to the high-ups in the Workers' Party. I was fortunate enough to visit one such private flat again after a few years. In the lift, the surveillance becomes visible again. There are people who document who in the building goes where and when. It's hard to imagine such a system. The flat I'm shown isn't a normal one. It's a kind of involuntary place of pilgrimage for Western journalists. It's stressed time and again that Kim Jong-un himself has visited the flat, but does anyone actually live here? It doesn't smell of anything. Everything's meticulously arranged, like in a catalogue. I find it hard to believe. I feel like I'm in a film in which Kim Jong-un is the all-powerful director.
On the 4th of September, we went to work. Suddenly, someone came by car. They were looking for me. They told me that the Supreme Leader was going to visit. I wasn't expecting that. Of course, it pleased me.
To me, that sounds as if Kim Jong-un were not just executing people, but also committing trespass. It's not clear to me what a dictator would be doing in someone's flat, but everything's different here. Even though most North Koreans have almost no money to buy anything to supplement their food rations, there are still supermarkets with Western products. They're not always open, and often many shelves remain empty, but it's a sign that there's a growing middle class in Pyongyang that is demanding an opening up, or at least certain luxury goods. As I mentioned earlier, a worker officially earns €5 per month. You can't buy much in a supermarket for that. The people who shop here are part of the upper middle class. The longer I'm here, the more certain I am it's the women who will force a cultural change in their country. Their clothes very obviously no longer conform to the propaganda line. They look Western. The desire for luxury goods has reached Pyongyang too, or at least the privileged. The women performing military exercises in front of me are shouting, "Long live the victory of Songun!" Songun means military first, and it's the name of the state ideology that gives North Korea's defense top priority so it can resist the imperialist threat from the United States and Japan. There's compulsory military service for the men of North Korea. It lasts 10 years.
The beloved leader was here 6 times. The venerable general was here 4 times. The current leader has been here 2x.
Who was where and how often? You're constantly being informed of that in North Korea. I'm visiting a state vegetable plantation.
423 families live here. New houses have been built to expand the agricultural collective.
I'm hoping to be allowed to talk to the workers here. I've been promised I'll be taken to one of the operations, but I can only see a few people in a place that's meant to be home to 423 families. On a small elevation that feels like a surveillance platform, I'm allowed to film the workers from a safe distance. It's really not what I had imagined, and once again, it's typically North Korean. Giving up isn't exactly one of my qualities, and so I insist on being allowed to meet the workers. I don't just want to see what I'm supposed to be shown. I'm here because I want to get to know the Korean people a bit better. To achieve that, I need to meet them. I finally convince my minders, and after they've made several telephone calls, a group is quickly assembled that take me to the greenhouses. As a side note, there's nothing in North Korea that's not meticulously organised. I don't think the word improvisation exists in North Korea. By the way, the red panel on the building says vegetables for the population of the capital. Regardless of all the propaganda and the, I'd call it brainwashing, the Koreans always manage to surprise me positively. It's always important to focus on the details during these human encounters, even though they're always organized and managed. Such meetings have an impact on the people here. I think it's the only way to separate the people from the propaganda. Pyongyang, the capital with a population of more than 3 million, is currently undergoing a construction boom. New skyscrapers are shooting up all over the place, shaping the city's skyline. If you look closely, you can see that South Korean brand names have been covered by North Korean banners. Like I said, you just have to pay attention to the details. I'm wondering where North Korea suddenly got all the money for these gigantic construction projects. Almost 80% of Pyongyang was destroyed in the Korean War. Over the course of 3 years, the United States dropped around 30 tons of napalm bombs on various towns and cities. Nevertheless, North Korea was economically stronger than South Korea until the 70s, thanks to the support of the Soviet Union. After that, North Korea slid further and further into isolation. It's not possible every day to film a live concert for workers on the streets of Pyongyang. In recent years, I've frequently tried to capture such images, but to no avail. This footage dates back to 2013, when I was allowed to film this everyday scene in North Korea while on a walk. A score for me. I'm allowed to take a taxi for the first time. For that to happen, my chaperone even had to call the foreign ministry. Of course, I'm not alone. I have minders to the left and right of me. As a tourist, of course, I paid three times the price, but that would happen in Rome and New York too. Thank you. I notice something new. It may seem insignificant, but this small picture of an aircraft belonging to a North Korean airline is an advertisement and a surprise in a country in which public images only ever show the godlike leader. It's new and maybe a first gentle attempt to open up the country to a globalized world. The taxi driver, who's missing his left thumb, drives me to a place you'd never guess. It's one of the most popular entertainment venues in Pyongyang. The ice rink, properly called the People's Ice Rink. In 2007, it was even one of several venues for the Women's World Ice Hockey Championships. The Austrian team played here in Pyongyang. What's telling is that the games in North Korea were the best attended, and clearly not because there are so many fans here. Pyongyang's middle class meet for ice skating, ice cream and beer on a Sunday afternoon. Unfortunately, I didn't get a martini, but there's table tennis, and the enemy, in this case, me, is allowed to play and win on this occasion. Pyongyang's cityscape isn't just changing architecturally. Young people have discovered rollerblading and can increasingly be seen out on squares where tanks normally roll, or at least used to.
Arrivederci.
Arrivederci. I'm not certain whether Italian's taught here, but it's a start. Speaking of Arrivederci, the Arirang Festival has always had a special fascination for me, as it has, I'm sure, for anyone else who's seen it. It's named after an old Korean folk song and tries to present North Korea's history in a heroic manner, using mass dances and gymnastics. More than 100,000 people participate, making it the world's largest dance event of this kind. If I look beyond the propaganda madness, the choreography is always hugely impressive. The Arirang Festival doesn't take place at regular intervals. It's normally held in spring and autumn, but sometimes it's not held at all. Anyone who participates, I'm told, gets a television or a fridge as a reward. The mass event is meant to commit the people to the political goals of the regime through the unmistakable imagery. I've attended the Arirang Festival four times now, but this time I saw something strange. People suddenly left the stadium while overseers tried to stop them. There was a large military presence around the stage. That's why I wasn't able to film for long. My minders wanted me to focus on the show. Was that a form of resistance? Maybe there really are people in North Korea who don't want to accept a third member of the Kim family as their leader. Something else historic happened during my last visit. The controversial Slovenian rock band Laibach was the first Western music act to give a concert in Pyongyang.
But I think what our concert here in Pyongyang shows is that both sides have been willing to work with something which is really hard, where both sides have need to stretch to their outermost limit to make this project happen. And that is what I call real and true cultural exchange, when both sides come together and sacrifice something for the common result.
So, after Mickey Mouse, Western music has also reached North Korea. Even the lyrics were translated into Korean, as can be seen at the top.
I think that the live concert, which you saw, would not have been possible without the three or four big cultural collaboration projects that came before it. Music is a language without words, and which is possible to understand in many different ways. And this is the magic of music. You cannot have like a user's prescription for music. I felt for the first time that I understood the lyrics. When Mina, the vocalist, sang "Nothing is gonna change my world" to a Pyongyang audience of 1,500, that was a magical moment for me.
"Nothing's gonna change my world" is the perfect sentence for a country that has kept every kind of Western music away from its people. It's not uncommon for people caught with South Korean films or CDs to end up in a concentration camp. Up until now, Western music could only be heard in the few karaoke bars for foreigners. Will Laibach go down in history in the way Bruce Springsteen did in East Germany? We'll see. For me, the North Korean people are cheerful and optimistic. At least, that's what the people I met showed me. I think the North Koreans know that nothing lasts forever. There are people that want to live in peace, but because of mistakes made during the Cold War, they're forced to live in a permanent state of war. When I ain't lying next to you, just can't stop. For my part, I can't repeat often enough that I feel happy among the North Koreans. I've been able to make friends. The trips of recent years have taught me that blanket condemnation and generalizations serve no purpose. Either in Europe or in North Korea, a country I still know very little about. Shadow.